MiniTube. Settle down and watch MiniTube. Welcome to MiniTube, and this is going to be my first tutorial. We're going to be making some potatoes, and I've learned that potatoes are a forgiving first project for you polymer clay enthusiasts because they're lumpy and they're different sizes, and so it's a pretty forgiving project. I have made a couple of other things this week, but I want to just take you through some of the materials that you'll need first for making your very own potatoes in many colors, shapes, and sizes. We've got Buffalo Bill here to help show scale. Start with polymer clay in a couple different beige colors, a ball tool with a fine end, some chalks in various potato colors, an X-Acto knife for cutting, and your hands and fingers. All right, ready to go? Let's go. All right. Here's a pretty fun, easy part. We just get some beige clay here and stretching and twisting and making it softer. And we're gonna roll it out into a tube shape. If your clay is a little bit too sticky, you can blot it between pieces of paper to soak up some of that polymer juice. But this clay was in pretty good shape. So I'm just rolling and rolling, making it longer and longer until it's about a quarter of an inch or so wide. It's a little bit wiggly and wavy, but that's okay because the potatoes are going to be lumpy too. Flip it over for no particular reason. And then with an X-Acto knife, you can just start cutting your potato pieces. And, you know, once again, the cool thing about potatoes is they're all different sizes and shapes. And so these do not all have to be the same exact size. Just cut as many pieces as you want potatoes. I typically make about 20 things anytime I'm making something like this. 20 potatoes, 20 peaches, 20 souffles, I guess. And then just start rolling each piece between your fingers. Make sure it's kind of a lumpy potato shape. It's pretty easy to make something that's lumpy and imperfect. Resist all temptations to make perfect circles because potatoes are flat in some places, bulbous in other places, lumpy in some places. And so don't spend a lot of time on any one potato. Just, you know, roll it until it's roughly potato shaped and then just put it back down. I had fun making potatoes this week. I tried a couple of different colors as you saw in that opening footage, and you'll get to see a picture of all the potatoes again at the end. There are all different colors of potatoes. You can do purple potatoes, there are Yukon gold potatoes, red potatoes, russets and baking potatoes that are kind of rough in color and texture. I'd like to try doing sweet potatoes at some point too, which I think would be a fun project. But these are just kind of your all-American baking potatoes. And so now it's time to add a little bit of color. And I've got this great little melamine dish and some of my Faber-Castell chalks. I'm just using the X-Acto knife, I'm scraping a little bit of chalk into the bowl. This ends up being a great little bowl for it. It's got kind of high sides. And so you just scrape a little bit in, choose a color that's close to what you want, and then just choose another color for a little bit of depth and more interest. And then I just started throwing potatoes in there. And then we're gonna shake it up a little bit and add the chalk to the outside of the potatoes. Of course, you could paint these individually one by one. This is a quick way to add the color, and it's kind of fun too. Shake them all around. It makes the chalks kind of land on the potatoes in a more random way. And isn't that really how nature creates potatoes? So once you've got chalk on the potatoes, you can start kind of rubbing the chalk with your fingers to kind of cement it on. Remember, the polymer clay has not been baked yet at this point. And so it is a little bit sticky. And just giving the potatoes a quick rub helps that chalk to stick on. I had decided at this point that they needed a little bit more of a brown red. And so there definitely was still plenty of time to add more chalk to the potatoes to give them the color that I wanted. And again, just rubbing and rubbing with your finger, and that kind of helps to cover up all of those white parts peeking through. You might say, well, why not just use brown clay to make potatoes? And you definitely could do that if you had some brown clay. I have found so far that using the chalks just adds a little bit of realism. It not only gives a nice texture, but like I said, the color is, nature is not good at creating like flat color that's the same all over. And so it's a little more like nature. At this point, I'm rubbing potatoes, and then with each potato after I've given it a little massage, I'm using one of my ball tools with a very fine ball tip on it to add the little places where the eyes of the potatoes would be. And I'm just putting three or four on each potato in kind of random placement. That one I think got five. But you don't want every potato to be the same. Make sure to kind of mix things up and make each potato its own unique being. And you can see you still have time to reshape the potatoes as you go too. Make them your perfect potato. And a perfect potato is an imperfect potato. You can see there I used the side of the ball tool to create a little flat area. Sometimes you'll get a potato that has grown next to a stone or grown next to another potato, and you've got like a little bit of a dent on one side or a flat place. It's kind of a cool project because you really don't need to be a perfectionist to create a perfect lumpy potato. A gentle touch is all you need here. You don't need to push very hard to make a dent in the clay or to drop your potatoes. And they're already looking real good, I think, at this point. At this point, I made some more potatoes because, like I said, I like to do things in about 20s. So I cut some more off, shaped some more potatoes, and I used slightly different coloration on the chalks just so that the potatoes wouldn't all look identical. And again, you're just following the same technique of scraping a little pastel into your bowl, shake, shake, shake. And there you've got some more potatoes. And you can see the color is slightly different. Maybe you can see it on your screen. I can definitely see it in person where they're just a little bit different. And darned if those don't look like miniature potatoes. I'm gonna rustle around in my supplies here and pull out my metal ruler so you can kind of see about how big these things are. Buffalo Bill there is a standard size US nickel, but you can see each potato is about a quarter of an inch wide or so, and a quarter of an inch in 1/12 scale is the same as about 3 inches. So these are miniature representations of what would be a fairly standard sized potato. Some of the potatoes I showed you in the beginning are smaller because those varieties are smaller, and some of them are larger. The baking potatoes I made a little bit larger. So at this point here are all the potatoes that I made, about 20-ish, and I want to make them look a little dirtier, like they haven't been cleaned off totally properly. And so I'm using a very dark charcoal gray color chalk, and I'm just scraping the chalk directly onto the potatoes to create little kind of dirt spots. I grew up in North Dakota, and our soil up there is nice and black. And so to me, this is what potatoes look like at the grocery store, a little bit of that good black dirt on it. While my potatoes are baking per the manufacturer's instructions, I thought it'd be fun to also give you a little bonus tutorial on how to make paper grocery bags. So I gathered up some supplies I had around the house, which include a paper bag, a pair of scissors, a pencil, and an Omni ruler. These grid rulers are typically found in the quilting section at a craft store, and they're actually really handy for craft projects like this because you can see through them. At this point, I remember that I'm right-handed and that the ruler needs to go the other direction. But I decided that the bag that I was gonna make was gonna be about an inch tall, and which would be the same as a 12-inch tall bag, and 3/4 of an inch wide. So I made the top portion of the bag an inch tall, and then I did a 3/4 of an inch line for the bottom of the bag. And then I'm gonna start marking off the sides of my bag. So I'm gonna start with 1 inch wide for the back of the bag, and then I'm gonna do 3/4 of an inch wide for a side of the bag, and then an inch again, an inch, Teresa, an inch, no, an inch, thank you, an inch wide for the front of the bag, and 3/4 of an inch wide for the side of the bag. You'll also need one little strip, maybe 1/4 of an inch or so, to glue these pieces together. And that's what you got. Okay, so here are the lines on the paper bag that, again, was just something I normally would have thrown away or recycled. And you've got all of the markings ready to go, and then you just cut it out. Now, I was a complete weirdo and just cut on the wrong lines. So I had to redraw the whole thing, and goodbye to bad mistakes. Oh well. So here is what you're going to actually end up with if you do things correctly. And then you're going to start folding. Now, it's obviously easier to fold where you can see the line. So the way that I did it is I folded with the line facing outward, but then you really want those lines on the inside of the bag so that you don't see them. I suppose you could leave them where they are, you know, fold outward and then maybe erase them, but you know, you never erase anything completely, do you? So I'm just, again, folding outward and then refolding the other way to create a bag shape. And this was kind of a neat little bag. I don't know where I got it originally, but it's not quite as thick a paper as you would get on a standard grocery bag. It was a much smaller bag. And now that I'm kind of dabbling in making miniatures, I'm just finding all of these kind of neat little things that I normally would disregard that I'm like, oh, I bet I could use this for, you know, making something kind of cool. So now we're gonna glue the bag together. Well, not quite yet, I'm gonna show you. So there's your little tab for sealing the bag shut. But I remembered at this point that when I made bags before, I made little handles on them, and I wanted to show you how to do that too, just so they look like a real cute little grocery bag you might get at a fancier grocery store. They all give plastic nowadays anyway, don't they? So this is just some, you know, craft twine that I had in a drawer somewhere, and I just cut two little pieces, and I'm gonna glue those on the inside of the bag. Now, glue sticks, kids use glue sticks, and they get your fingers all sticky, you know? So watch me kind of bumble my way through sticking this little piece of twine onto my little tiny paper bag. I'm a grown woman making miniature paper bags on a Sunday. Who would have thought? So anyway, glue the ends of your twine. I'm using just this little scrap of paper to keep it from getting all over my glass that I'm working on. And you just stick it on the bag. Now, if you find these fancier paper bags, sometimes they'll have a little strip of paper over the top of the ends of the twine so that it doesn't pull out. And I decided that that's what I would do once I can get everything to stay in place. Hang on, I'll be right back. I cut a few tiny little strips to hide the ends of my craft twine, and I'm just gonna glue those over the top of the ends of the twine. And this isn't only to just provide stability for the miniature, but also to kind of mimic what a real bag would look like that you get at a fancy grocery store. And once again, I'm sticking to everything at this point. Oh, Lord. All right, so we're gonna get this bag done. What are we gonna do? Sticking it down, and there, look at how cute that is. So now we can seal the bag shut, and there's that extra little quarter inch flap that we made, and you just tuck that in and glue it so that you're gonna actually put the glue on what would be the outside of the bag. Trace the outside. Oh yeah, I decided to fold in those 3/4 inch sides first to make like a gusset. And once again, this is gonna make it look more like a real grocery bag. If you don't feel confident doing this, there isn't any reason you couldn't leave them just flat. But I decided to be fancy and make little gusseted sides. And now we're gonna glue this bag shut. Once again, a little streak of the old glue stick. Once again, stick to other things and then loop it in and seal it shut. And you get a pretty quick firm hold with this glue stick. And there you can see how cute this little bag is looking. It looks like a real bag. Now, this part is tricky. And this is a way that I wrap Christmas gifts, I guess. You go in on the gusseted sides and you pinch forward, and you're gonna create little kind of 45 degree angles on the front and back, and then just pinch those down. So up and through and hold with the finger, press down on the side, and you're creating a little 45 degree angle, and pinch it so that you can fold those sides in. Now, these are not going to meet, and I didn't do it necessarily by design, but it's the way when I made other bags, it's they didn't meet at the bottom, and I don't know what I did or didn't do. This is still an easy way to make a bag, and the way to get around the bottom not meeting and the way to make the bottom of the bag a little bit more sturdy is to just cut an extra little piece of paper to glue to the bottom of the bag. And this is not a big deal. So you're going to just measure how big of a little piece of extra paper you need to cover the bottom. Just cut it a slightly bit smaller than the bottom of the bag is. So I did that. I cut a little piece of paper to cover the bottom of the bag. Easy schmeasy lemon peasy. And then I actually went ahead and folded the bag upwards on the bottom, once again creating a little crease to make it look like a real grocery bag. Take a look at a real grocery bag and you'll see what I mean. There's always that little crease so that the bags can all fold flat when they're just kind of waiting to be used. Take your time on this part to make sure you get a good flat fold. And so now the bottom of the bag is facing upwards, and this is going to make it real easy to glue this little extra strip on the bottom. I decided that my piece was a little bit too big, and so I just trimmed it down a smidgy smidgy and another smidgy smidgy, and then that's going to fit real nice. So once again, there's my little scrap piece of sticky paper now, and gluing it and putting it down on the bottom of the bag. And it works just as slick as can be. And you'd never know that this bag wasn't perfect. It's perfect enough for me anyway. Open it up and see you've got that little crease now on the front. And this bag is ready for potatoes. Pretty cool. All right, the potatoes are out of the oven and it's time to give them a quick glaze. Pretty pleased with how these turned out so far. This was a supply I did not show you in the beginning. Oh, wait a minute. Let me show it to you. It is Sculpey Satin Glaze. And this isn't going to make things too shiny, because potatoes definitely aren't shiny, but some of the varieties, like these red ones, do have a little bit of a, you know, kind of sheen to them. So I just have a little craft brush, and I'm going to paint over each potato. And I don't really find that the chalk rubs off much after it's been baked. You gotta remember that polymer clay is sticky when it goes in and it dries pretty hard, and I feel like it grabs onto the chalk pretty well, the pastels. And so I'm just painting each potato really to seal that color on, and you can see I am getting some color on my fingers. At this point, I'm pretty much completely messy. But just painting each potato, and I'm setting them down on a piece of tin foil. I learned the hard way with the first batch of potatoes that I made not to set them on a piece of paper, because when the glaze dries and then you try to pull it off, you end up pulling a little piece of paper with it, and that's just not the look I was going for this time. Potatoes are dry at this point. The glaze has dried, and I'm just revisiting my other potatoes that I showed you at the start. I really was pleased with how these turned out. These are baking potatoes, and my oldest son Harrison said he felt these were the most realistic looking. And I have to agree, they're pretty big. They're about 5/8 of an inch or half an inch. And so these are big, big baking potatoes. And I didn't glaze those because I felt like that kind of potato has a little bit more of a dusty look to it. These are little purple potatoes. If you've never seen them, Google it. They're pretty cool. They're purple on the inside too. And more purple potatoes. I also made some... These were my first red potatoes, and they ended up a little darker than I wanted. I still like them. And so there they are. They're a little bit bigger probably than I would have wanted them to. One of the things I'm learning about miniatures is make everything a little bit smaller than you think you need to. These are Yukon Gold potatoes. I'm pretty pleased with those. They look like tiny Yukon Gold potatoes. If you're wondering how I achieved this look with these potatoes, I did use several different chalks, and I scraped them into a bowl just like I did with the other potatoes. But I used, you can see there, I used this kind of gold color. I used another kind of beige color, and I used gray on top of that. And I did at the end paint on a little gray. I chipped some chalk into a bowl and then used a paintbrush with a little bit of wetness to it and brushed on some gray too, just to make them look extra kind of dirty and grungy. And so now the purple potatoes, I got to use a pretty purple one, and I added some gray to that one too, just to kind of dial it down a little bit. But make potatoes that are the color you like and make them the size you want. And it's kind of a fun little project to make potatoes. All right, I feel like I've said the word potatoes about 100 times. Here they are again, just one last kind of glamour shot with the little bags. Aren't they cute? And this was my first tutorial. I hope you liked it. I'll do more. I'll try to make them shorter next time. I'm also still learning how to make videos, and it's been a frustrating process, but I am enjoying learning this new hobby. I thank you for coming. Buffalo Bill thanks you for coming. And we'll see you next time on MiniTube with the Kitten Stitcher. Bye-bye.